2 mic line or instrument inputs, 6 line level inputs, 10 line level outputs, a headphone output, and even more channels via the digital I.O. All that in a small form factor and with a superb audio quality? That's what Moto promises with their Ultralight Mark 5. Let's have a closer look. Hey, Julian Kraus here, and this is the Moto Ultralight Mark 5. As always, let's first check out the hardware, then have a quick tour of the software, and then I'll show you some measurements I made to see how this interface really performs. On the front of the Ultralight Mark 5, you can find two XLR and TRS inputs, which can be switched to accommodate microphone, line level and instrument connections. Further to the right, you can find a 1/4-inch headphone jack and a dial above it. With this dial, you can change the headphone and main output volume. You switch between them by simply pressing the button. You can also see which one you got selected on the screen, but I'll get to that shortly. The rotary encoder lets you adjust the volume in handy 1 dB increments. Sadly, the encoder has no velocity control, so each step is always 1 dB, and if you want to make big changes, you have to turn the dial quite a bit. Turning it too fast can actually skip a step, which makes the volume change even slower. Maybe Moto can add a velocity sensitivity to the dial with a firmware upgrade. By the way, you can also turn the interface on or off with this button. For that, you simply have to press and hold it. The Ultralight Mark 5 also has two gain knobs, which controls the gain in 1 dB steps, all the way from 0 dB to 74 decibels, which is a lot of gain, and I will talk more about that when we check out the preamps. By the way, the settings on both channels match very closely, which is perfect for stereo recording setups. The dials are also used to navigate the menu. For each front input, you also find phantom power controls and a pad which attenuates the incoming signal by 20 decibels. I know you've already been peeking at the OLED display, and not without reason. This is really handy to have, as it shows you the audio levels for all the in and outputs. The level meter is clear and easy to read, and properly shows the level in dBFS, which is marked on the left side. On the right side, you got even more information like sample rate, clock source, digital and MIDI I/O activity. Due to the high contrast of the black and white display, the levels are very easy to see, and I really like the screen implementation. My only complaint is that it is a bit hard to see when a channel is clipping. Yes, you can see that the level meter hits the top, but there's no obvious indication like a red blinking LED or something like that. Enough about the front, let's check out the rear of the Ultralight Mark 5, and boy did Moto plaster every millimeter of the rear panel with I/O options. On the far left you can find a power connector, where you have to plug in the provided power supply, otherwise the interface does not turn on. The Ultralight Mark 5 uses a USB-C connection, and Moto provides you with a USB-C to USB-C and a USB-C to USB-A cable. You also get a MIDI in and a MIDI output, and an optical in and out. The optical connection works with Toslink and ADAT. If that wasn't enough, you also get a SPDIF in and output via RCA. As hinted in the intro, the Ultralight Mark 5 features 10 balanced TRS line level outputs and 6 balanced TRS line level inputs. All in all, the construction of the Moto is really robust, the housing is mostly out of metal, and the controls feel very tactile. Now, I know you want to have a small look inside, but what's this? Tiny torque screws? Why Moto? I guess there's only one way now. Okay, I'm kidding. Because of the many in and outputs, Moto went with an AKM AK5578EN for the analog to digital, and two ESS ES9026 Pro for the digital to analog conversion. And that doesn't surprise me a bit, because they proudly display that on their website. Why did I open up the interface again? Regardless, these are excellent converters, and just based on that, I would hope to see an excellent audio performance. But I guess we'll find out soon enough. Random side note, the whole interface gets a bit warm when using, that's totally normal. Okay, let me quickly show you QMix 5, which is the software from Moto which you have to use in order to control all the features of this interface. And man, are there a lot of them. So many, in fact, that I can only give you a small overview of what you can do with the Ultralight Mark 5. First of all, you can set the gain for each input individually in the software. The outputs can also be controlled individually and additionally be linked to the main output and change their volume accordingly. The headphone volume is of course controlled separately again. The Ultralight Mark 5 also gives you an incredible routing flexibility. For your headphones, the main mix and 5 stereo outputs, you can create individual mixes to monitor your audio. On top of that, you can add EQ, compression, a gate, and even reverb with the built-in near-zero latency effects. I want to point out that these effects only work with a sample rate up to 96 kHz. Now, I measured the latency with all this digital mixing, EQ, and reverb applied, and the delay is still only 0.7 milliseconds at a sample rate of 48 kHz. This is imperceptibly low, and that's why I have no problem calling these effects real-time effects. Speaking of delay, I also measured the round-trip latency of the Ultralight Mark V, and it's not the fastest that I measured yet, but it is quite good. Please keep in mind that the round-trip latency is heavily dependent on the sample rate and buffer size. Here you can see the times I got with 48 kHz, and here with 192 kHz. These times can be improved by about 1 more milliseconds if you set the safety offset to low latency. Let's go back to QMix 5. As I understand it, the EQ, compressor, gate, and reverb are primarily designed to be used for monitoring, but you can enable loopback and then send the whole processed mix back to your recording software and essentially add real-time audio processing to your recording. Oh yeah, I didn't mention that before. The Ultralight Mark V also has a loopback feature, which is quite handy. That's it about the software, let's talk about the audio performance and start with the two microphone inputs. The frequency response is very flat, which means that all frequencies in the audible spectrum are recorded equally well. Compared to other interfaces, the frequency response stays the same regardless of the set gain, which is really nice to see. Now, dynamic range is another important spec, because with a high dynamic range, you can leave yourself a nice amount of headroom without introducing additional noise. The mic inputs on the Ultralight Mark V come in at 118.8 dBA, which is a huge dynamic range. Needless to say, this is really good. Let's have a look at the distortion, and with a typical microphone level signal, we can see a steadily descending THD plus N, which means that all distortion components are lower than the noise floor. And when we have a look at the total harmonic distortion versus frequency, you can see that across most of the frequency range, the mic inputs deliver an incredibly low THD plus N of around minus 110 decibels. This is an excellent performance, and in fact so good that this measurement might actually be limited by the performance of my audio analyzer, and the real performance of the Ultralight Mark V could be even better than that. Now, how about preamp noise? Preamp noise becomes especially important when you record with low-sensitive dynamic microphones. The Shure SM7B is one of these low-sensitive mics, which accentuates the preamp noise of the audio interface. So this right now is pretty much a worst case scenario, and I will be quiet for a second to let you listen to the noise floor of this setup. That's very low noise, and my measurements confirmed that. The equivalent input noise, which is a way of stating the preamp noise, is at minus 129.8 dBA weighted. That's a really good value, and here you can see how this performance is compared to other audio interfaces. One question I get quite often is, do you need a Cloudlifter, Fathead or DM1 with the interface? And I can confidently say that you really don't need an inline preamp with the Ultralight Mark V. And there are two good reasons for that. First of all, the preamp noise is already so low that adding an inline preamp will only lower the whole noise floor by about 1 decibel, which is negligible in practice. The second reason is that the Ultralight has a lot of gain. Even with the SM7B, I did not have to max out the gain fully. I measured the maximum system gain at around 76 decibels. The average I see from other interfaces is usually around 50, so the Ultralight has about 26 decibels more gain available, which again underlines the point that you do not need an inline preamp with this interface. Now let's have a look at the line level input performance. While testing, I found that the performance of the two line level inputs on the front is slightly different to the ones on the back, and you will see that in the measurements. Starting with the frequency response, you can see that it is pretty flat in the higher frequencies, but it does have some amount of roll off in the lower frequencies. 2 decibels down at 20 Hz is definitely not the end of the world, and I doubt that you'll ever hear this in a normal recording, but the roll off is definitely there. The line level inputs on the rear, interestingly, do not show this behavior, and they are essentially ruler flat in the audible range, which is an excellent performance. The dynamic range is also different, although not by much. The rear inputs have a really nice dynamic range of 118.7 dBA, and the front inputs still have 116.2 dBA, which is great in both cases. In terms of distortion, the rear inputs once again outperformed my audio analyzer, so this might not be the exact performance of the input, but it shows that the THD plus N is better than at least minus 113 decibels. That's really, really good. The frontline level inputs show a tad more noise and slightly higher third order harmonic, and that's why the THD plus N is a bit lower. But at this point, we're splitting hairs here. Okay, so the takeaway here is that there is a slight difference between the front and rear line level inputs, and the rear inputs perform ever so slightly better. But regardless, both the front and the rear inputs perform extremely well and show inaudible amounts of noise and distortion. Alright, the Ultralight Mark V has some nice inputs, but how about the audio outputs? Here's the frequency response of the line level output, and it is very flat, which is exactly what you want to see. There is some tiny amount of roll-off in the lower frequencies, but that's not something you can hear. The dynamic range is excellent with about 125 dBA, and at the maximum output, the Ultralight Mark V delivers a proper professional line level of 18.5 dBV. That's really good and exactly what you want to see from a device like this. Now let's look at distortion, and you might notice a reoccurring theme here. Yep, the distortion is once again so low that I had a really hard time measuring it. This performance is very likely limited by my audio analyzer, but regardless, you can see that the harmonics easily sit at or below minus 120 decibels. So if it wasn't obvious already, you won't hear any distortion from the input at all. In fact, because of the low noise and distortion, I can confidently say that all the line level outputs on the Ultralight Mark V are completely transparent, meaning that you will only hear the played back audio without any audible amounts of distortion and noise. After seeing such a good line level output performance, the big question is, how good is the headphone output? I know this table is getting a bit overloaded, but it lets you directly compare all the interfaces I've measured so far, and the color indicates how an interface performs in a particular measurement. No worries, I'll quickly go through them and tell you what this means in practice. The frequency response is once again very flat in the audible range, and it easily extends above and below that, which is exactly what you want to see. The output impedance is very low, and this keeps frequency response variations to a minimum, regardless of the used headphone impedance. The amount of power the Ultralight Mark V can provide is very good, and it can easily drive the majority of headphones to a very loud listening level. Still, power-wise, I would have expected even a bit more, especially because the interface has a separate power supply, but it's fine as it is. The total harmonic distortion and noise is very low, both with low impedance and high impedance headphones. There is a slight rise in distortion with low impedance headphones, but even shortly before clipping, this is still below 80 decibels, so I wouldn't worry about this. The noise of the headphone output is also very low, and with over-ear headphones, there's virtually no chance that you will ever hear any noise from this output. The channel balance is perfect with 0 dB, and that's because the volume of the headphone output is digitally controlled. So even at low listening volumes, the left and right side of your headphones are going to be equally loud. I noticed that the crosstalk is a little higher than I would like to see from such an interface. This means that there is a small amount of audio leaking from one headphone channel into the other. It is still low enough to not be noticeable, but the Ultralight Mark V could have been arguably slightly better in this regard. Overall, this is a very good performance of the headphone output. So, what's my verdict? Moto really delivers on their promise in terms of sound quality with the Ultralight Mark V. The mic inputs utilize ultra-low noise preamps with tons of gain. The distortion on all inputs is negligibly low, and the dynamic range is excellent. All 10 line level outputs are fully transparent, as linear and non-linear distortions, as well as noise, is way below the threshold of audibility. The headphone output also performs very well and has a good amount of power to drive the majority of headphones on the market. Aside from that, the Ultralight Mark V also has some really nice features like independent mixes for all the outputs and real-time effects for monitoring. My only complaint would be that the effects are a bit limited. The equalizer, for example, only has 4 bands. In the gate effect, you cannot adjust the ratio, and I would have really liked to see a limiter to keep things in check after the applied effects. Nevertheless, I think the effects can be quite useful, and I actually really liked the sound of the built-in reverb. Now, I think the biggest selling point of the Ultralight Mark V is still the plethora of in and outputs, and it's really nice to see that Moto can produce an interface that delivers a superb audio quality with all this I/O in such a small package. If that's something you're looking for in an audio interface, the Ultralight Mark V might just be the interface for you. That's it for now. Like, share, and subscribe, and I will see you all in the next one.